Welcome back, everyone. I'm James Murphy. Python 3.12 has just released. Here's my take on all the latest and greatest. My company's mcoding. We do software consulting. Check us out at mcoding.io. Fans of static typing will be pleased to know about the biggest change in Python 3.12, the new syntax for type parameters and the type statement. When defining a generic function in Python, you can now declare any type variables for the function in brackets like this. Previously, you would have had to import typevar from the typing library and then create your own type variable like this, making sure that the name that you assign it to matches the name in quotes here. That's no longer necessary, just put brackets T. You could also put multiple type variables like this, typevar tuples like this, and param specs like this. You could also constrain the allowed types like this, or like this. This syntax is even more convenient for defining generic classes. Previously, defining generic classes was very confusing. You have to import stuff and define your own type variables, and then you have to learn about category theory and pick the right type of variance for your type variable. That used to be super annoying and confusing, but thanks to Python 3.12, it's now no longer necessary. You don't even have to know about covariance anymore. Python just does the right thing, it automatically determines it. You can now also use the type keyword to define your own type aliases. You could sort of already do this by declaring a type alias like this, but this usage is deprecated. And notice that this type alias is defined before expected is defined. That's fine, these type aliases are evaluated lazily. And they can even be generic too, go wild. This new syntax is going to make generics in Python a lot less cumbersome to write, so if you love static typing, I rate this 8 out of 10. If you hate static typing, I'll still rate it 3 out of 10. Next up, PEP 701, f-strings are now officially, formally part of the Python grammar. For historical reasons, they used to be implemented in a kind of hacky way. One of the consequences of that hack is that you couldn't use the same kind of quotes that started the f-string inside one of the f-string expressions, without escaping. Python would see that quote and think you're trying to end the f-string in an unbalanced way. Well, no more, you can now put whatever expression you want inside an f-string, including another f-string. But of course, just because you can doesn't mean you should. Keep things readable. All around, this is a great update that gets rid of an ugly wart that Python had. 9 out of 10. Next up, PEP 684, a unique per-interpreter GIL. Did you know, you can have multiple Python interpreters in the same process, even in the same thread? Here, an interpreter means the part of Python that runs in a loop reading and executing Python bytecode. The main purpose of a sub-interpreter is to provide isolation. Each sub-interpreter is like a little sandbox that can execute code independently from the other interpreters. It has its own globals, imports, etc. An example usage is something like mod WSGI. For security reasons, a web server serving multiple different applications should keep data for each application separate. Therefore, mod WSGI creates a sub-interpreter for each application group. When a request comes in, a worker will acquire and use the sub-interpreter dedicated to that application group. So where does PEP 648 come in? Well, Python has this thing called the GIL, the Global Interpreter Lock. But that also means Python is limited in multi-threaded performance because only the thread that currently holds the GIL can actually run Python code. While sub-interpreters do provide isolation, there's still a small amount of state that's shared between them. And in particular, the GIL is, or was, shared between them. This PEP makes it so each interpreter gets its own GIL, which will allow true multi-threaded performance in Python for the very small number of projects that actually use sub-interpreters. In summary, a per-interpreter GIL is a great idea. It just only applies to a few projects, so 6 out of 10. Have you ever tried debugging your Python application and found it to be unbearably slow compared to when you just run it normally? Introducing PEP 669, Low Impact Monitoring. Well, here's a direct quote from the PEP. By using quickening, we expect that code run under a debugger on 3.12 should outperform code run without a debugger on 3.11. Previously, Python debuggers worked using sys.settrace, which allows essentially the same functionality in a less efficient way. The new sys monitoring namespace provides a clean API to register for events, and the implementation details allow it to take advantage of the ongoing work of specializing instructions at runtime. Quickening, as it was mentioned before, is the process of replacing slow instructions with faster, specialized versions at runtime. This is all part of the Faster C Python project, link below. Anyway, better debugging, I'm definitely in, 8 out of 10. Next up, better error messages, particularly for common typos. Did you forget a self dot somewhere or use the wrong syntax for an import? Now Python will tell you exactly what you did wrong. These are small changes, but literally every developer benefits from better error messages. 10 out of 10. Ah yes, PEP 683, Immortal Objects. This is a juicy one. Do you run a Django app with over 2 billion monthly active users? If so, this is the most exciting Python 3.12 update for you. You see, if you have 2 billion users, you're going to need to fork a lot of worker processes to handle all those requests they generate. Good thing forking is so fast on Linux because it uses copy-on-write. But wouldn't it just be a darn shame if every read in Python was also a write? Oh wait, every read in Python is also a write, because when you read a Python object, first you increase its ref count. That's a write. Too bad, that's going to trash your cache and ruin your day. Introducing Immortal Objects. Twiddle one of those high bits in an object's ref count, and poof, it's now immortal. Immortal objects do not participate in ref counting because they're meant to live forever, at least until interpreter shutdown. There's no point in keeping track of how many people have references to none, true, false, and other global immutable built-ins. Make them immortal too. With immortals, now you can have a read that's really just a read. 2 out of 10, I don't have 2 billion monthly active users. Next up, PEP 709, Comprehension Inlining. Previously, dictionary, list, and set comprehensions like these were defined under the hood using functions, meaning it literally compiles the inside of a comprehension as a separate function, which it then instantiates and calls immediately. That creates a bit of overhead because you now have to create this function object and create a stack frame when you call the function. Well, that's no more, they changed the implementation, dictionary, list, and set comprehensions no longer use functions under the hood. All the comprehensions get compiled inline inside this function. Hopefully you won't really notice this change. You'll get a slightly different traceback if you have an exception inside a comprehension because there's no longer this stack frame associated with the comprehension. And since comprehensions are now compiled inline, you can now see the local variables of the outer function with a call to locals as opposed to the local variables of that inner lambda function scope. I mean, it's a tiny improvement, but why not? 6 out of 10. Next up, PEP 688 using the buffer protocol from Python. The buffer protocol is a common interface allowing many libraries like NumPy to interoperate as long as they can conceptualize their data storage as some kind of n-dimensional array determined by a few properties like the number of dimensions, shape, strides, and element size. Previously, the buffer interface was only accessible in the C API. This PEP exposes that interface to Python by adding two new magic dunder methods, dunderBuffer and dunderReleaseBuffer. The usefulness of buffers in Python is limited, but it could be useful for debugging or potentially building a bridge type that connects to C extensions. I probably won't use it. 4 out of 10. Next up, PEP 692 using TypedDict to annotate kwargs. The default way that you annotate keyword arguments in Python is not very intuitive. Kwargs is always going to be a dictionary, and the keys of the dictionary are always going to be strings. So originally, Python decided that that means you just need to annotate the value type. So if I annotate kwargs as an int, this means that it's a dictionary of string to int. That's already confusing enough, but also, when would I want just an arbitrary number of extra keyword arguments that all have to be integers? If you have a use case, I'd love to hear your thoughts, comment below. If I was going to take a bunch of keyword arguments, I'd probably want them to have some specific structure. A typed dictionary seems like a perfect match for defining the structure of a dictionary, so why don't we use that? We can't just type in kwargs as a movie, because remember, that's going to be interpreted as a dictionary of strings to movies. Well, in 3.12, they added unpack into the typing library, which instructs the type checker to do what you would hope it would do. Namely, treat kwargs like it's supposed to be one of these typed dictionaries. I'll give it 4 out of 10, I guess. I would really prefer to do this instead of using kwargs, but kwargs are part of the language, so we should at least be able to type them properly. Next up, developers who are paid by the line of code are going to love this one. PEP 698, the typing override decorator. Let's say you have a class hierarchy. We have a base class shape that has a calc area method. Then we have squares and triangles that are both shapes. Both square and triangle have their own specialized way of calculating their area. The programmer then uses the override decorator to signal that, yes, this implementation of calc area is meant to be an override of something in a base class. This doesn't really do much at runtime, but when we run our type checker, we find a problem. The method used to be called getArea, but we did a big refactor and it's now called calcArea. But it looks like we missed a spot and there's still a getArea floating around. The base class may have even had a correct, albeit slower, implementation of calcArea for the triangle. So potentially, all of our tests still pass. But because this method is marked override and there's no getArea function left in the parent class, this now becomes a type error that we can catch at static analysis time. There's also a suggested strict mode that would make it a type error if you didn't mark the function as override when it was overriding something in a base class. This could potentially stop you from accidentally overriding something in a base class that you didn't know existed in the first place. My only fear is this might be the second step along the way to becoming C++ with their public static const expr auto const override that you need to slap on every definition. Hopefully it won't come to that, 5 out of 10. Next up, PEP689 introducing the unstable C API tier. Lots about the C API in this release, huh? This PEP introduces the unstable API, which has the same compatibility requirements as the public API, but does not require deprecation warnings before change. So this contains things that are basically expected to change with every version of Python. This would be useful for something like a debugger that might use specific opcodes that are only valid in specific versions of Python. Currently, everything in the unstable tier is related to code objects. So unless you're using the C API, this probably won't affect you, but good to be aware. 6 out of 10. And the most painful change, not even a PEP for this one, setuptools is no longer included by default in a virtualenv. This change is undoubtedly going to break some people's builds. Setuptools has been the default and de facto standard for building and packaging your Python code for a long time now, and many people generally expect it to be there. With that said, setuptools is no longer the only build system for Python, and it doesn't make sense to pre-install it. Pip still works even if setuptools is not installed, but it's still painful to break someone's build, so I'll give it a 1 out of 10. But ultimately, I do agree with the pip team that this needed to be done eventually. There's also a ton of tiny improvements to many libraries, but I'm not going through all those. Let me just mention my favorite gem, itertools.batched. 10 out of 10, I rate batched over and over again. It's in like 80% of my code bases. Glad to see it included in the standard library. All it does is split an iterable into batches of a fixed size, in this case 3, so I get 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, except the last one might be shorter. And finally, saving the best for last, the absolute most awesome part of Python 3.12 being released is that Python 3.7 is now past its end of life and I can drop support for it in all of my code bases, and Python 3.8 has a year to go so I can start pushing clients to upgrade to 3.9. Again, I'm James Murphy. Don't forget to check out my consulting services at mcoding.io. Thanks to my patrons and donors. See you in the next one.